Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nastahdihi wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya lahu. Wa nashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu. ونشهد أن سيدنا وسندنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكمه الكتاب الكريم ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها صدق الله العلي العظيم وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر ولا يدخل النار من كان في قلبه مثقال خردلة من الإيمان أو كما قال حبيبنا صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. There are many teachings that we learn through Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us through the Qur'an, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us through the ahadith, that the ulama and the scholars and the sahaba and the tabi'in and the tabi'at tabi'in always emphasized upon. And the later it got, or the further away it got from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was more constructed and it was divided more and it was made easier for us to understand. You look at the tariq, you look at the ahadith. In one time, there was no such a thing as a hadith being sahih or a hadith being da'if. All the ahadith were known as good. And then a time came where people didn't have the best of memorizations, when they weren't able to keep the ahadith the same way the sahaba did. So then came sahih and da'if and the different narrations or the different ways or the different levels of hadith. And just like that, going on. And then came Asma'ur Rijal, making sure that you know who you're taking the hadith from. If a hadith is taken from such and such person, then the hadith is usually weak. Or if a hadith is taken from this person, the hadith is strong. And just like this, it kept going on. And for us, when we look at it, it's been made very simple. The people have done the work. The scholars have done the work. We open up the commentaries and we'll see if this hadith is sahih, if it's acceptable or if it's not. Just like that, there's a very important aspect in our deen that is overlooked many times. And that is our spirituality with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention in one place of the Quran, إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّءِ, that at times the same nafs, our desires, tell us to do something wrong. In another place of the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes reference of the same nafs as a very relaxed and peaceful nafs at the end of Surah Al-Fajr. يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةِ. And at times this nafs is moderate. It doesn't tell us to do something wrong, neither is it telling us to do something right. It's very moderate. The purpose or the goal for a Muslim should be that I want my nafs to be nafsul mutma'inna. I want it to be content with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given it. You want a mutma'in, a content nafs, working towards this. But there are also a lot of sicknesses a person goes through. The same way we have our physical body, our physical appearance, and at times we get sick, we go to the doctor and ask the doctor, what medication should I take, or what precautions should I take for this sickness that I might be going through? The same way the ulama rahimahumullah ta'ala, and the first who really went into this field was Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayh, who aside from learning ahadith, aside from learning the Quran, aside from learning the deen, he spent a lot of time and he made this our own category of Islam, tasawwuf. Going closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by Jibreel alayhi salam, mal ihsan? What is the definition of ihsan? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَى. A Muslim, a mu'min, should be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with such devotion that it's as if he can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if this first part is not easy for him, then at least the second part should be easy. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ. If you cannot imagine seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of you while you are fulfilling these obligations, فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at you. So these two points are what ihsan was told to us by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Being further away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not seeing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not seeing the Sahaba, not seeing all these great things that could make our iman a bit easier. You see, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, having the iman wouldn't be as hard as for the people who are to come later and wouldn't see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, pertaining to the people of Jannah, he said, I wish for my brothers to be with me. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are thinking that, you know, we are the brothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But one of them goes and asks, O Prophet of Allah, who are your brothers? Who are you referring to when you say brothers? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions, those who will come after you and they have not seen me. They will come after you and they have not seen me. Those are my brothers. Those are my brothers. This is the kind of virtue Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sahaba were given their own virtue, radiyallahu anhum wa radu'an. The people that come after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the Sahaba, they were given their own virtue, that they are called the brothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Going back to topic, the hadith I mentioned, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioning that a person who has the slightest atom of kibr inside his heart, this person will not enter Jannah. This person will not enter Jannah with the slightest atom of kibr. This person will not have entry into Jannah. What is kibr? Obviously, it's such a big thing that a person not entering Jannah, even if he has the slightest amount, what is this? Kibr is when a person does not do anything, or this person is trying to boast about something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. He is proud about something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. Not only is he proud, but he is thinking of himself better than the person next to him. This is what kibr is. Being thankful for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you is not wrong. But bragging about it, boasting about it to someone else and thinking of yourself superior to the person next to you, that's what kibr is. A person then said to the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this hadith, when he heard this saying from the Prophet ﷺ, he asks, O Prophet of Allah, I like to wear good clothes. I like to wear good hats. I like to wear good shoes. I like to ride a nice camel, a nice horse. Is this also part of kibr? The Prophet ﷺ says, no, this is not part of kibr. Wearing good clothes is not against the kibr, or is against kibr, it's not part of kibr. Riding a nice car is not part of kibr. All these things are not part of kibr, because these are part of jamal. The Prophet ﷺ is saying this is part of beauty. Inna Allaha jameelun yuhibbul jamal. And verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves beauty, and He loves that to be shown on others. So this is not kibr. But having that superiority, or thinking you are superior to the person next to you, that is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is referring to. One time, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is seeing a person eating. He tells this person, oh, such and such person, eat with your right hand. Out of pride that, you know, he's telling me something. Maybe who am I? Why is he telling me something? I am such and such person. He has no right to tell me this. This person says, I can't eat with my right hand. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that point makes a dua against him, that may you never be able to eat with your right hand. And till this person, till his deathbed, he was never able to eat with his right hand. Again, kibr. Thinking of yourself better than the person next to you. It is fine. There are two different things. One thing is ikmal, one thing is afdal. Ikmal is when a person says, I've learned for 10 years, this person has learned for 2 years, maybe I know more than this person. Maybe. Afdal is when you say, I am better than this person. You don't know who's better than who. A person who probably never studied the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you, even though you might have studied for 15, 20 years. Because this person was sincere for that single second. If you weren't sincere, in what you were doing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't matter how many years you study, how many years you serve the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's no use. Because that person who spent a single second for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that second will help him in the akhirah. That second will help him in the akhirah. Being sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and making sure we have no kibr. Kibr is part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's part of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you try to adapt something that is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or yet when you are trying to establish a position for yourself that is only worthy and right for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are messing with a king. You are messing with the kings of kings. It's not going to end well for any person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنْدَهُمُ الْعِزَّةِ فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. The mushrikeen, the munafiqeen would go and help the non-Muslims of Mecca and Medina at both times. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being told in the Quran that these people are trying to help them. They're trying to gain some power. They are trying to gain some social position in their community. أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنْدَهُمُ الْعِزَّةِ. They are trying to go to these people and think that they can give them some position. But remember, إِنَّ الْعِزَّةِ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one with the power. If He wants to give a position to someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give that position. If that position is not to be given to you, then there is no one who can do anything to get you that position. The first sin you look at in history, dating back all the way to the time of Adam alayhi salam, was what? It was Iblis being told, oh Iblis, prostrate to Adam. Bow down to Adam, make sajda to Adam. He says, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ, I am better than Adam. And you think about it, Iblis had a point. Iblis had a point, is fire not better than clay? Is fire not better? He had a valid point. But it is not the point that he made. It is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to do something. And he thought he was better. Fire is better than clay. But even then, the mufassirin have written this. The muhaddithin have written this. That he had a point. He made a valid point. But that was not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted. Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not know that fire is better than clay? He was fixing Iblis. He was letting Iblis know, oh Iblis, just because I gave you this fire does not mean you are better than someone else. قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ. This was the first sin ever committed, dating all the way back to the time of Adam alayhi salam. And what was his punishment? He was kicked out of Jannah. He was kicked out of Jannah. He was not allowed entry into paradise again until Yawm al-Qiyamah. He will always and always try to take people like us, and he will try to make us go astray and try to make us come in the same sin of himself. There are many vices of kibr itself, aside from the fact that a person will not get entry into Jannah, just in this world. If a person thinks of himself as the greatest of people, if you look at the documentary of one of the greatest boxers, Muhammad Ali. Now, I was in Kentucky, I never had a chance to actually meet him. But this person, he, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him in such a way. He says that he has some problems, he has some disease pertaining to his mouth and something along with that. So he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is punishing me because when I was in the arena, I used to say, I am the greatest. Allah is punishing me in this world because I used to say I am the greatest when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides people. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that guidance is written for someone, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what work is to be done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can use the most randomest people or the most famous people in the world can come towards the doors of the masjid when they realize or when Islam is written for these people. So anyways, Iblis was kicked out from Jannah because of the sin of kibr. And along with kibr, there comes many other evils, such as pride, or such as hasad, such as bughd, hating one another. When you think of yourself as something, and someone else does something for you, or someone asks you to do something, you feel bad. Why did this person ask me to do this? Why did this person ask me to take the trash out? Why did this person do this? Why did this person do that? Everything becomes hated to you. You don't like what anyone does to you. You don't like when anyone asks you to do something because you feel insulted. You feel insulted because of that kibr. You get mad easily. Someone says something to you, you get mad. Why? Because you thought you weren't worthy of doing that. You didn't think you were worthy of taking out the trash. You didn't think you were worthy of picking up the dastarkhan or picking up the mat after you're done eating. But you look at the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you look even in the Quran gives the best of balance between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being a rasul and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran mentions in Surah Kahf, inshallah, either we all read it today already or we are going to read the first 10 and the last 10 at least of Surah Al-Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba walam yaja'al lahu iwaja. Being a slave is the lowest of positions in society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using that position to remind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam firstly, and then all the Muslimin that are to read the Quran, that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned, even when we say our shahada, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, we remember that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a higher status amongst the Muslimin because of him being a rasul. He even has a higher status amongst the anbiya because of him being so beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at the same time, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being mentioned as a abd. And the same way, likewise, in another place of the Quran, in Surah Al-Furqan, you look at the last ruku', the first thing mentioned about Ibadur Rahman, the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are attributed with ibad. This shows us a very beautiful indication in this ayah mentioned by Imam Qurtubi, Imam Ibn Kathir in their tafasir. They say that the first step to getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to becoming beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is adopting the attribute or the quality of abd, of a slave of Allah. Put yourself, remember you have to serve Allah. Meditate upon this, you have to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How will you serve Allah as a slave? Put yourself in this, just think about it. How am I going to be a abd, a slave of Allah? And then the ayah goes, the verses goes, very beautiful portion of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the qualities of Ibadur Rahman. Maybe sometime, inshallah, we can go over these qualities as well. In other places of the Quran, or the ulama rahimahumullahu ta'ala took the Quran, took the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about kibr. And they mentioned few things a person can do just for by himself to try to cure these diseases that a person might have, these spiritual diseases. For kibr in itself, the first and foremost thing a person needs to do is meditate and think about his reality. If a person knows his reality, think about what he does, the bad he does, the filth that comes out of this person. He will know his reality of an insan. Look at the Quran, Allahu alladhi khalaqakum min nutfatin thumma ja'alakum azwaja, and different places of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us from dirt, from literally filthy dirt. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say. Then you became a clot of blood. And then it kept going like this and this. This is the reality of insan. Embrace the reality and turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is when we can gain this quality of abd. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala truly give us the ability to start cleansing ourselves with the spiritual diseases such as kibr, such as hasad, such as bughd. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to read the Quran, and may this Quran be a means of cleansiness for our hearts, for the diseases that we might have, so that when we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are pure like the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and our entry into Jannah is easy and fast. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the understanding of the Quran and Hadith, and the ability to practice upon that which has been said. جزاكم الله خير وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين